Phil Dike was born in 1906 in Redlands, California. He attended Chouinard Art Institute in Los Angeles and eventually went back to teach there. In 1928, Dike moved to New York City and studied at the Arts Student League while living at the YMCA with Ted Geisel, also known as Dr. Seuss.
When he went to New York, to the Art Students League in New York, it was during Prohibition. Mm-hmm. And one of his best friends was Ted Geisel, who is Dr. Seuss. And they used to get into a lot of trouble. They lived at a YMCA, and they were on the fourth floor, and there was a speakeasy across the street from them. And when the cops would come to attack the speakeasy, they'd get bags of water and throw them on the cops and do all kinds of hijinks. So he loved New York, loved that whole period of education there. And so then when he went to Europe, I think it was just one of the great experiences of his life. And at that time he was obviously very comfortable with traveling and doing things. And his wanderings of Europe and Italy and just were amazing, and the paintings that came out of that experience. So I think that he knew that he got his foundation, true foundation, through that experience. But he only talked about going back to Europe once, and that's when I was in the eighth grade. And he had a sabbatical planned at Claremont, and they were going to go the next year. And something happened. Canceled it and didn't do it. But I never heard any other travel plans for him. And as far as I know, he never traveled out of Southern California, Southern and Central California, for the rest of his life.
In 1930, Dike moved to Paris and studied at the American Academy of Fontainebleau. He traveled and painted all across Western Europe and studied the process of lithography in Italy. He eventually moved back to Los Angeles in 1931 and taught at Chouinard until 1934. In the 1930s, Dike received an enormous amount of success and national attention, which was rare for such a young artist. The relationship between technical skills and philosophical values was of major interest to Dike as a painter and a teacher. He emphasized the value of both skill and control as an artist, and believed in the importance of having a compelling interest that draws one to select just the right parts of an idea in order to create a sensational visual experience.
This one has pieces of all the stuff we've looked at practically, because it's got abstraction, it's got black-lined elements, it has realist nudes, it has all of them, in one package, which, I think is just a killer piece. And, it's almost cartoonish as it's been tipped up. The perspective is just tripped you up like this, and you're looking straight down and you're looking out, and then this vanishing point that's running out here. So all these different things, these shapes, are doing all these things and pulling you back in and taking you back out, pushing you out. And so you'll see that in a lot of his work, that he's constantly pulling your eye around to make sure that you've got a strong feeling of the whole piece, and you don't get tied to one focal point that captures your attention.
Dike was very active as a young artist and traveled quite often. He went to Arizona, Mexico, and New Mexico in 1932 with his brother Harold. He painted and grew as an artist as he was exposed to new sights that inspired new techniques in his art. In 1933, Dike married the love of his life, Betty Love Woodward.
But tell me, Donald, have you ever been to Bahia?
No, I haven't.
No? Oh, I am so sorry for you. Ah, Bahia. It is like a song in my heart. A song with love and beautiful memories. Que saudades que eu tenho. Ah, Bahia. I close my eyes and I can see it now. I can see the beautiful twilight in the sky. I can feel the breeze from the bay. And I can hear the music of Bahia.
In the 1930s, Dike worked with Walt Disney on classical films such as Snow White, Fantasia, and The Three Caballeros. He worked on backgrounds with the animation department for Snow White, who is a story developer for Fantasia, and a color consultant for live-action sequences for The Three Caballeros.
This is Chouinard, who owned Chouinard Art Institute in Los Angeles, was really a close friend of Walt Disney's. And Walt Disney knew as he unfolded Disney Studios that he needed artists. And so he was one of her benefactors and really encouraged her as a owner that he needed to make that happen. So when Phil finished at Chouinard's and went on and did his studies abroad in New York and came back, he started teaching at Chouinard's. And Mrs. Chouinard came to him and said, Walt Disney would like to hire you. And so he went and met with Walt Disney and they did make a deal. And, Disney, that period, 1935 to 45, especially 35 to 42, or in that period as the war came around, was really stimulating because it's a focused trip, and Disney was super focused. And so I'm sure there are people that did not, get along and did not work out and was not perfect, but my dad was very, very close to Walt and Roy Disney, who was very much a part of it too.
In the 1930s and 40s, Dike was an active member of the California Regionalist Movement and was also elected president of the California Watercolor Society in 1938. He remained president until 1939. He and many other watercolorists like Brandt, Millard Sheets, and Phil Paradise were a bold group of artists that set the foundation for California's art scene and put it on the map as a true contender and contributor to the art world. Before this group's efforts, California was not considered a big player in the art scene, and watercolor was not considered a fine art medium by the majority. Woody Dike was born in 1941 and became the subject of many of Dike's paintings for the next several years.
Being a part of a art family is, sort of a balancing act of trying to fit into what an artist wants to do in their life and how an artist is, in this case, a father I feel that it if you look back on it, I think there's definite stress between of sharing a father or a mother with them being an artist, because their intensity of direction and thought is extremely wrapped up in what they're doing. And they're sharing their children has a little bit of a secondary role that I feel was not easy. And I felt that, you know, my mother was the same way. She was protecting my father from the world. And, you know, I felt that there was a little bit of a lack of activity there. So that's my own personal, you know, take on it. And obviously, I'm still here. But I think that the good pieces of it were that I grew up in an environment that was creative. Mm-hmm. And that I actually had the opportunity to have people around me that were doing things that were fun, and the house and the environment was interesting, and there were interesting people coming in and out of the house.
Dike left Disney and continued to pursue more independent projects. He created several illustrated storybooks for his son, and designed covers for various magazines. He focused more on his role as an educator and continued to inspire young artists in Southern California. He founded a summer school in 1947 with his friend and colleague Rex Brandt. The Brandt Dike Summer School of Painting was in Laguna Beach, and it lasted for several years.
I think that Phil left Disney because I think it's burnout. I think you guys hit that really well. I mean, you taught me that a little bit this morning. That just came to my brain from our discussions. I think that he'd done his job. You know, he'd really gotten the animation group up and running. They'd done fabulous things. They'd won awards and whatnot. And I think that he wanted to be a little more independent, a little more personal, and rather than being part of a machine like that. And so I think you guys hit it on the head. I believe he was probably psychologically not in great shape at that point, and he needed a break. And he did go back to Chouinard's after that, and he was there for about 4 or 5 years when this offer came from Scripps and from a graduate school. Rex Brandt was a young art student, and my dad met him walking on one of the beaches in Newport. And Rex was coming down the beach with his drawing equipment over his shoulder, and so they started up a conversation and ended up becoming friends. And so they started the Brandt Dike School of Art in 1947, I believe. And it was in Rex's house on Goldenrod Street, where the white footbridge goes across the canyon. And it was this just really cool, low-key deal where they had an art store in Rex's studio, and they had an outdoor studio with a trellis, and just wonderful people from all over the country would come to in the summer for 6 weeks. It was in the first 6 weeks of the summer. It started in June and went to the first August. And they worked on basics there at the studio, and then they'd go out on location and paint the cannery or paint down the cove or whatever it was. And it was mostly Phil and Rex and Joan Irving, who is Rex Brandt's wife. But George Post would come down from San Francisco, and guest artists would come. and Robert E. Wood, that I showed to the nude and whatnot, he would come and teach. And I was the janitor, and I'd pick up all the cigarette butts, which were there were millions of them. So that was a big smoking period of time. But, you know, we'd have one summer Rex and Joan were up in their place in Washington, on one of the islands, Shaw Island or one of the islands. And so Robert E. Wood and his wife Joan, the first wife, would came down and spent the summer. And we had all these young gals there that were from colleges. There were there, five of them that were taking courses. And there was hijinks all summer. I mean, there was just, you know, one of the gals was driving her father's Model A Ford. And Bob Wood would jack up the back wheel and put a block underneath it. So she'd go out and start it and put in gear and rev it, nothing happened. All kinds of things. So it was, it had a playful sense to it, but it really was the most probably exciting place to come and learn how to paint water.
By the 1940s, Dike's painting became more abstract, and he started painting in a geometrically abstract style of calligraphy. So, could you explain like your background and how you, how much you know about Phil Dike? How you, when you first started learning about him?
Do I look at you?
Wherever. Probably. Wherever feels comfortable.
Well, I went to work for a private collector in 1981 who had a fairly extensive collection of what's referred to as California school paintings. And three artists in his collection dominated the collection, and one of them was Phil Dike. And in 1981, Phil Dike was still alive, as was Millard Sheets and Rex Brandt and quite a few other of that group were still alive. And so I ended up meeting Phil Dike and his wife, Betty Woodward, and really liked them, visited them at their home in Claremont, and just got to know them. And he was a really nice guy, very quiet, very unassuming, but he's an interesting artist because of how he kept changing his style. He kept responding to changes in the art world, and he changed his style a little bit as he went along. And yet, I found that I liked everything he did. So it didn't matter whether it was something he did in 1932 or something he did in 1972. I still like them quite a bit.
Can you explain a little bit about his style, how it changed? And I know he moved a little bit more toward abstraction after Disney.
First of all, most of the artists like Phil, who Phil was born in 1906, and he went to Chouinard School of Art in Los Angeles, and the teachers there at the time were artists that were basically representational kinds of artists. His favorite teacher was Clarence Hinkle, who's somebody I also ended up studying simply because Millard Sheets and Phil Dike loved Clarence Hinkle so much as their teacher at Chouinard. And so when they first started painting, both Sheets and Dike, their very early paintings looked like some kind of modified impressionist style. But then, starting around in the early 1930s, as the American scene and regionalism started developing in this country with artists like John Stuart Curry and Grant Wood and so forth, they also started changing their style, moving away from this impressionist look into a more realist, but not painted with that choppy brush stroking and so forth, smoother planes and finishes. But that continued throughout the 1930s, basically. And then around the beginning of the 40s, a lot of the artists started changing a little bit. And even though they were all members of the California Watercolor Society, and they had exhibitions in New York City, and that continued through 1946. But after World War II, they all kind of started going different paths. And a lot of that just has to do with how old they were, and they had families, and they had to find other ways to support themselves and support their families and so forth. So it wasn't just focused on painting. Dike began exploring a semi-abstraction in his work right around 1940, 41, 42. And he still retained a sense of representation. You knew what you were looking at, whether it was a beach scene or a rocky point or farm scene somewhere, but he just started painting a slightly different way. And this continued up until all the way to the end of his career, and it kept getting more and more semi-abstract. He bought a home in Cambria in the late 1950s, early 60s, and when he would go up there and he would travel around Big Sur, and suddenly Big Sur had a whole different look than the Southern California beaches had, and he changed again. He became very bold in his style. But eventually, by the end of his career, he had developed a what they call the wave series, or these striated patterns, bands of color, and integrating human figures sometimes, but they were very ephemeral looking into his work. So that's where he was at the end of his career in the 80s.
In the 1950s, Phil Dike and his family spent a lot of time in Cambria, where Phil Dike bought a cabin that was designed by one of Frank Lloyd Wright's students. Along the Big Sur coastline, Dike really got into abstraction, a decision that his environment definitely helped him to develop. He expanded his subject matter and painted different types of nature scenes. He did a series of paintings on the Big Sur coastline from 1955 to 1958. He expanded his medium to writing as well. He wrote poetry at the cabin in Cambria with themes of nature and ocean life, much like the subject matter of his paintings.
When we moved to Claremont from Los Angeles in 1950, where Phil took an assignment from Miller Cheats, who was the head of the art department at Scripps College and Claremont Graduate School. Plus, there were a lot of artists in Claremont. That was a hotbed of artists that were teachers there. And so I got to know a lot of these artists, and a lot of them did not have kids. And so I became sort of their kid. And so, it was quite fun.
During the 50s and 60s, Dike taught at Claremont Grad School as well as Scripps College. Phil Dike passed away at 84 in 1990. His contribution to art will never be forgotten. He was one of the first exponents of a new bold approach to painting watercolors that became known as the California style. His paintings of the California coast give a vibrant portrayal of life on the bay, the harbor, and on the shore. His perception of his environment was dramatic and beautiful. His love for color, light, and atmosphere is obvious when you look at his paintings. Although several paintings by Dike appear to be spontaneous abstraction, each piece by Dike was meticulously and carefully thought out, and the result was always stunning.